I heard about the leak. I was like, there's no way they're getting Garfield, but like it's legit.
Dude, that's nuts.
So
Side Smash is gonna be him pulling out box of
lasagna. Alright, what's up guys? Welcome back to the podcast. I'm Alex. I'm joined by Norbert, longtime member of PBC. And we're also joined by our newest member of PBC, Jesse. I actually brought him onto the team. About,
I've been here for a while now.
We've
had newer members.
Yeah, he's been here.
I think it was like 6 months ago, maybe.
I think so. I've been working with you guys for a while now, and I'm just a mostly video editor, but also shooter. I do mostly video for you guys.
Mm-hmm.
Getting into photography, really like photography. I recently bought Sony, sponsor of Sony.
Mm-hmm.
From,
Which one?
It's A7III. I'm not trying to ball out.
So quirky, you have an A7III.
I saw the A7IV come out, and I saw that it was like a $2,500.
Mm-hmm.
Dollar deal.
Good
like,
deal. Good deal.
Dog, honestly, I don't know. With the deal that I actually got on the A7III that I bought, that's I got $1,200 off, basically.
Oh snap. Wait, how much did you so you got the A7III for what, $1,600 then?
No, I got it for $13.
$13?
$13.
Oh my god, that is a good deal. Wait, what lens did you get for it?
No lenses, just the body.
Mm-hmm.
I got two like really good just like a maxed out SD cards. You can film whatever you want, like S-Log3, 100 megabyte per second type deal, and just one battery. And I got an A1 strap, which is cool. So like
for no reason an A1 strap.
I went ahead and I put a little sticker above the A7III logo on the camera.
Yeah,
and
you put the A1
strap. I have the A1 strap, so now people just think I own an A1.
So people think you're a baller, and then you actually go in and shoot, and it's like.
Then when they edit, like, dude, where are these like other 20 megapixels?
Yeah, I actually like tried to buy the A7IV, but I forgot I have an $1,800 spending limit on my credit card, so it declined. I thought about it, like, wait, I don't need this right now.
I think we talked about this.
It was
a
good thing.
What bank are you with?
Bank of America.
Why do you only have an $1,800?
I don't know. I tried expanding it, but like I don't have like a on paper salary, you know. Because I'm not like an LLC.
You don't need that. I mean, the last time I checked,
they asked for that.
That's
for
so.
Me.
Move banks. Go.
Did you call them?
I did.
Oh, and they said they couldn't.
Yeah,
do it.
Yeah.
What?
It's fucked. I don't know.
That's so bad. What?
Anyways, this is so like this is so out of topic.
And by the way, Alex's bank number is
social security number.
Okay,
is
so let's bring this back to Jesse. So Jesse, what do you do outside of like work?
Yeah, what do you do for fun, man?
Well, not so much now, but I'm going to get back into it. I bike a lot.
Mm.
I would bike from my house to Huntington Beach, which is just a really nice, like, hour and a half, 2 hour trip. I think it's similar to what Norbert's trip here in Irvine, where you just go down to, it's Newport, right?
Yes, I bike down to Newport, but my trip is only about 1 hour, typically.
Mm-hmm. Well, you also bike a lot faster than me. I mean, you have gears on your bike. I have a single speed.
Oh, man, yeah, definitely.
But I enjoy having a very simple single speed bike, because I'm not trying to mess with, like, I need to replace my chain.
Mm-hmm.
I do not want to mess around with different gearings and just mess that up.
Right.
So, yeah. I bought my bike from Germany. I went to Germany last year, almost 2 years.
Oh boy, he's talking about Germany again.
Yeah, I kind of.
Wait, did you import the bike from Germany or did you?
No, I brought it on.
He was physically in Germany.
Wait,
so,
like on the plane.
On the plane. So I went to Germany to study abroad for 6 months. I bought a bike there and I didn't want to leave the bike over there because it was, one, pretty expensive.
Mm-hmm.
And like, I'm not just going to waste this money to have a bike over here for a few months and then just dip. So I bought a ticket for it. You can buy tickets for a bike. It's like 60 euros. It's pretty great.
Oh, that's really cheap. To America.
To wherever you're going.
For 60 bucks.
For 60 bucks. I got a bike box from a local shop, and it was so stupid just like biking down Hamburg with a big ass box on my back, like one hand on the bike. I don't know. I looked really dumb. But I got it to my dorm, fitted in there. It was my first time taking apart a bike, so it kind of felt like a mechanic, which is really cool.
Nice, nice.
Yeah, and then like after you came back from Germany, you're like a biking like maniac.
I was a biking maniac.
You would,
yeah.
Ask me to bike, I was like, I'm tired.
Dude, we biked only once, and I had to stop for you what, 6 times on the way.
Yeah, because that's my first time biking.
Yeah,
like, that much.
So I live relatively close to Alex by car. By bike, it's like a 30 minute trip.
Yeah.
I biked over to his place. He took me on his. No, I took him on my route, which is pretty different from wherever you go.
It goes up and down. It's hella
steep.
Yeah,
mine goes up.
No, it
goes
so
up and down, and it's just a straight line. But Alex like just goes downhill, so he has no condition to go uphill at any point.
Fat.
I'm not. You do kickboxing. I haven't done exercise in like a year, brother.
Yeah, you're fat.
I am a little fat.
Anyways,
no, I'm not fat. I've got a little bit of dad bod right now, but I'm hoping that I can work on that.
More biking.
My girlfriend recently stayed, so I wasn't able to bike as much just because I was trying to maximize my time with her.
That's
which
nice.
Is great. Which is great.
Yeah.
Where did your girlfriend go?
My girlfriend went back home to France because I actually met her on the study abroad trip.
Oh, in Hamburg.
In Hamburg.
Oh, wow.
We were both studying in the same, not the same university, but we were both staying in the same dorm.
Mm. Was she also doing like a study abroad thing, or was that more domestic for her?
A little more domestic, because there's this deal that France has with Germany for the law program. Because you guys may not know it, because I didn't know it, but France and Germany had a lot of beef, like going
yes.
back
yeah, oh,
from
yeah.
the wars and stuff. And
might have something to do with because Germany maybe invaded France or something like that. I don't know.
I never paid attention in high school. But
and speaking of high school, so me and Jesse have known each other since sophomore year of high school, and you can talk about how we met.
Yeah,
briefly.
A little tangent. I've known Alex since freshman year of high school when we had a smash tournament.
Well, it was freshman year, and then sophomore year we became active.
Yeah,
friends.
Actually, like freshman year, I was introduced to you as just like the guy to try to beat in the smash tournament, and I lost too many times to you, so I was very ashamed. But the next year, we just hung out in the same friend group type deal,
yeah.
and got closer because of video games. But yeah, a lot of shit has changed since then. It's great. But yeah, going back to like the whole France and Germany thing, she was there on a special stay where she's able to just study between France and Germany consistently. Right now, she's back in France on an internship, and while we were there, we just met after a little party. We walked in a park. And I don't know, I just got like that, those little high school butterflies that you would get.
Aww.
Like having a crush in high school.
Gross.
I haven't felt that in a while, so I'm very glad that I felt that with her. Shout out to Ori.
How nice.
Yes.
Insert picture.
Shout out to Ori.
What I'm curious about is where did you get the tools to dismantle your bike? Like you said, you did it yourself.
I did.
In your dorm.
It's crazy. Biking is really huge in cities, especially like Hamburg. Especially in just all of Europe in general. So I went out of my dorm, they have a little bike rack with tools attached to it.
Oh, okay.
And you just throw your bike on and just start dismantling everything. That's what I did.
Mm.
It was really nice that they just provided that for us. I didn't know how to change out a tube for a long time until I actually came here. So I would just go to the shop and they would just jip me out of 20 euros to change a tube. And it's almost,
$20 to change a tube?
No, that's like $25 here.
Oh my God. Yeah, you got a little scam there.
I hated it so much.
Dude, that's crazy. I mean, speaking of inner tubes, there was this guy I once met when I was selling a bike back in college who told me that in his country, I don't know if this is true, but I feel like he's lying to me because I tried to look it up, couldn't find it. He told me that the inner tube in his country is called a camera.
Yeah, that's what.
Wait, is that real?
It's what it's called in Spanish, la cámara.
Oh shit, that's real.
Yeah, it's a real thing.
He was lying the whole time.
It's that's what is the inner tube of a bike is called. Camera.
Oh, okay, wow.
Cool.
Something
interesting.
My dad, when I was younger, I had a little like a kid's bike and stuff, and the inner tube broke. My dad's like, oh, tienes que arreglar la cámara. I'm like, oh, what do you mean I have to fix a camera? What camera? You're not recording me right now. I was just a dumb kid. I didn't understand the camera I was the inner tube. I also just didn't understand how bikes worked. So,
Dude, that's interesting. I did not know that. That's very interesting.
Yeah, so anyways, so like Jesse, you're on the same boat as me. We're both film students in our last year. And so being a film student, how does being into, you know, the wedding and photo industry, how's that changed things for you?
Honestly, studying as a film student gets me very worried about just financial security.
Yeah,
all the time.
Especially with the recent IATSE things that have been happening. And just
recent
like,
what things?
IATSE.
What are the IATSE things?
I forgot the specifics. It's just an organized, like the unions in the film industry have had enough of just like the unfair treatment of the crew.
Of like 14-hour work days?
Yeah, so work days typically in the film world are 12 hours.
Yeah.
But those 12 hours don't really account for like tear down and driving back home.
Yeah.
So realistically,
14
it's
hours,
like 14 hours sometimes.
And it's not 14 hours like for one day. It's like sometimes you're working for like
four weeks straight.
4 weeks sometimes for features.
Not like months.
Yeah.
You'll be working those long hours and you're expected to drive home and show up the next day on time. You don't have much time to spend with your family. And so that kind of goes into what I've found to be like a pretty good middle ground for me, because I enjoy wedding photography, I enjoy wedding videography, editing for Paper Birch is great. And the biggest thing is that it's more of a stable thing. I don't want to be worrying about my next gig, because that's just something that I don't think I could raise a family on. I very much want to have my family in good standing with my career.
So Jesse's basically using us as like financial stability.
What makes it worth it
is that like I would choose like being on film sets like over this, like on my own projects.
Mm-hmm.
But working with you guys makes everything really worth it, you know?
It's the people, really.
Yeah,
it really
is. Like literally if you're working with like asshats, why are you working in the industry, you know?
Yeah, I've worked on film sets where there's just people I don't know. And knowing people on a set really makes it so much better.
Yeah, it works for that and it works for
weddings.
Yeah.
Like I'm sure you guys have talked about it before where it's like, oh, I love working with Paper Birch not just because it's a good place to make good money, it's more about the people.
No, it's
because
we're fruity.
We're all friends.
Yeah.
We smack each other's butt cheeks every
grab
ass
with G, yeah.
Actually.
It definitely is much nicer. I actually had shot with a couple other groups way back in the day. We have kind of an interesting dynamic because we don't have a high turnover rate. If anything, I think our turnover rate is decently low. Like the only people that turn over are people that went on to do bigger and better things, but they still stay around and still, you know, work with us every once in a while.
Mm-hmm.
But these other companies that have really high turnover rates, I mean, they're not like bad people. It's just like, I don't know. It's a different kind of feeling.
It is a lot more business oriented for them. And, you know hard feelings, right?
It's
just
not
fun. If you want to move on and do bigger, better things in the wedding business, go ahead. No one's going to stop you.
Yeah.
But I don't know how you're going to keep consistent good friendships with that, with people who are in that same business. And I think we just have something special.
Yeah, we're starting a wedding frat. It's like the start of one. It's like the start of one, basically.
Who do you know? Your name by back.
But yeah, that's a good thing about work. What was your first like experience working with, you know, PBC, and how was that?
Wait, I actually kind of forgot my first experience.
You started as an editor, right?
I did start as an editor, but I remember for a long time, I was just trying to get into contact with Alvis, because I was telling you to tell him that I'm available for jobs. I was like, hey, Alex, I know you're doing a lot of stuff with Alvis right now. If he ever needs another shooter, just drop my name or something.
Yeah, sure, guy. Wait, do you know Alvis before Alex?
No, I know that Alvis hit you up on Twitter and stuff, just like kind of
Instagram.
Well, potato, potato. He kind of inducted you into the group and you started working for him. And when I saw it, I'm like, ooh, I kind of want a piece of that pie. So I asked you if I could like come get involved. And then eventually you just told me that Alvis is looking for an editor. I'm like, I can edit. I mean, I can do some wedding stuff. I met up with Alvis in just one of the Vietnamese plazas out in Westminster. And honestly, I'm kind of socially anxious. It's kind of a miracle that I'm speaking so well right now. we turned up at a little Vietnamese coffee shop, and I sat down with it. I'm just like, my leg was shaking like crazy, and I'm just like, this guy is holding the keys to like my happiness.
To funding my girlfriend's food.
Funding my girlfriend's food. funding our trips to San Juan Capistrano. But it was pretty good. I realized Alvis was actually pretty chill. He gave me a hard drive to work with, and we got on a Discord and just like started talking. I think I met G that day too through Discord. It was a little video call. And I felt a lot more relaxed once we started talking about and the fact that Alvis is up half the time he's alive.
The second
Alvis pulled out just his highly modified in front of the camera, I'm like, oh, okay, at least I can feel safe around him. So it was really like
it was me who made you feel comfortable.
G honestly made me feel pretty comfortable in the group. First wedding that I did with you guys, I met up with G and I met up with it was you as well and Alvis. I think it was us four who had a Dana Point wedding, no?
I think so.
Your first wedding was a Dana Point wedding?
My first,
was
yeah,
that,
no, it was
the
Dana Point
Occasions?
I thought it was the Occasions.
No, it was the Occasions, you're right.
Yeah.
My first wedding was at the Occasions, and I don't know, I didn't know what to expect. I was just very nervous, felt very green. Alvis handed me a camera, and he's like, okay, when they're going to do ceremony, I want you to run over to that stand and throw the camera onto the 70-200. I'm like, okay, cool. I'm going to go grab B-roll. Grabbing B-roll, whatever. And he's like, oh, it's happening right now. I'm like, oh, crap. So I run over. I'm just like trying to dismantle a Sony, which I don't use. And he's like, he takes it apart, snaps it on there. And I'm like, okay, I got this. And I'm pointing. And I'm pointing, and I didn't press record, and I'm pointing.
Oh, man.
I didn't know that. I missed, like, the first minute and a half of people walking down.
Okay, but we have 200 cameras, right?
We did. We saved it. It was fine.
It's fine.
But I felt really stupid. I was, like, freaking out. I'm like, damn, I messed up on the first day. I was just getting
fired right there.
I'm
going to
get fired. But,
I mean, it reminds me of my first day, like, being at a wedding with Alvis. I didn't mess up, thank God. But, like,
okay.
I felt the same kind of, like, I felt the same kind of pressure and, like, franticness as you. Because, like, I'm trying to learn, like, the flow of a wedding, you know? Because, like, I don't know what a reception is, really.
Yeah, I had no idea what the wedding lingo was about.
I don't know what vows are or whatever, you know, or first looks.
You've never been married before?
Yeah.
Oh, wait, have you guys not been to like a wedding personally before?
I've been to a baby. So I mean, when I was 4 years old, I was like the ring bearer, and I dropped the ring.
Oh, okay. You dropped the ring?
I dropped the ring in the aisle.
Is there footage of that?
No.
Can please pull up footage?
Yeah, I dropped the ring in the aisle because like I was trying to walk fancy as a 4 year old, I guess. Because
like strutting.
Yeah.
Strutting down the aisle.
I was strutting. I remember. So I dropped that. Anyways, but at least now I work at work weddings. So
a little less embarrassing. You still strut down the aisle with your gimbal, you know, just, like, ass out.
I wouldn't call it that, but
I don't know those unique little plans.
You stare at that. You stare at me when I use a gimbal.
I think we all have to stare at you. Honestly, I'm up on a perch with a 7200. I kind of have to see.
Oh my god!
Top angles are really nice on you.
We met through a video game, and that's Smash Bros.
Mm-hmm.
So, what's your relationship with like Smash Bros. Me and just How do you view Smash Bros. And what does it mean to you?
Nowadays, I'm not as passionate about Smash Brothers just because I haven't played it as much.
But we did like do some drunk Smash.
We did do a lot of drunk Smash.
That was fun.
Giving,
that was so
past.
Fun.
I don't think
you're just sitting there, dude.
But
well, for friends, Friendsgiving, he was just in there. Yeah.
My relationship to Smash Brothers is it goes way back. I never played Smash Brothers until Brawl, and I only started.
Brawl?
Yeah. I only started in, what was it? I was a fifth grader, and I was in an after school program called Summer Pride, where it's just a bunch of like middle schoolers getting together with like some adults taking care of us, one field trip every day, and when we're not on field trips, we're just in a room kicking it. They had a Wii. They had game controls, they had Wiimotes, they had everything that you could think of. And we just played Smash Brothers all the time. We also played Guitar Hero. I play Guitar Hero on Expert. My brother can kick my ass though, and I'm very disappointed. But I started with Smash Brothers as just like a really fun game that you can only play with four people. I did not know that there was a competitive scene. And when one of my friends was like, oh yeah, I play Melee, and I play Box, he's really fast. I'm like, cool. Can we run this four setup though? It's like, I'm trying to party. It's fun. But I only really got into the competitive aspect when Smash 4 came out in high school. And I had it on my 3DS. I kicked some kid named Andrew's ass in like the boys' locker room.
Andrew win?
Dude, he was such a cocky NES player. It just pissed me off every now and then.
You guys just have stereotypes for mains.
Actually,
he's a NES player.
Yeah, he's a NES player.
He's a
guys.
NES player.
Yeah, freaking side.
Those freaking
NES.
Samus players. Oh my god.
Okay,
he's a Samus
I
main
player. Samus.
But I think our best memories of Smash is like one, forming the first Smash Club at our high school.
We formed the Smash Club at our high school.
Yeah,
kind of,
and that led
into
the esports club as well. So we founded the esports scene at our high school.
It's kind of crazy that we did.
Yeah,
honestly, I didn't think we could ever pull something up because we had to pull some shit of like, how are we gonna spin this to be like educational for the kids? So
said charity.
We told our high school board, like, hey, we're gonna make this a charity driven association, which it was, and this also connects to our educational goals by tapping into psychological, like, what did we say? Like, it helps strategizing.
No, it was like building a safe community within school for
the nerds. I remember our teacher coordinator for the club was like, we need to spin this so that it's educational in some way.
Okay.
Like, okay, cool. Then let's just say that we're trying to strategize and have people think ahead. And that's it. It works. I don't know how we made it work, but
I mean, it is forward thinking because esports is now a legit thing.
If you can't read, you're not in esports, you know? Reading is like predicting your opponent's moves.
Oh, yeah, reading.
Mm-hmm.
And the second best thing with Smash was honestly like Evo, like going to Evo with you.
Evo
is like the biggest Smash tournament, and we went in
2018.
2018?
I mean, it was after I drank for the first time, so it was 2018.
Okay, yeah, so we went to Evo for 2018. So we went with my family, and like that was like me and Jesse like competing together. That was so fun.
Yeah, Alex. No, your brother made it pretty far. Andy.
Yeah.
Andy made it into like his third set of pools.
Second
set of pools.
Yeah.
I died in my first set.
I died at the very end of the first pool.
Yeah.
By some Japanese players.
Do you remember the streamer that I went up against? Who I low-key crushed his spirit. This guy, I totally forgot his name, but he is a streamer who like dropped everything and decided to dedicate everything to Smash and become a pro Smash player. And I was like researching him and stuff on YouTube.
Like what, 10 followers maybe?
10, you know? No, he had like 70
okay,
followers.
Okay.
Was he just starting
up and coming?
Yeah, he was just starting. And I was looking at his gameplay, I'm like, I can kick this guy.
Oh yeah, because before a tournament, you know who you're fighting the day before.
Yeah, you're told who you're fighting.
Yeah.
So I look this guy up, I'm like, okay, he's not that big of a deal. Went up onto the match, and I realized it was a little too easy.
Oh
so
my god.
I low-key went onto my secondary, which at the time was Lucina, and stunted on him like 3 times.
Yeah.
And
no.
He kind of left with his head down. I felt really bad.
Yeah.
I'm about to end the man's career.
I ended
his whole career.
Wasted $40.
if you're out there, I'm so sorry. I apologize. But after that, I went up against an actual player who was on a team, a Little Mac player. And I mean, it's Little Mac. I'm like, it's not can't be much. I'm just going to zone him out with Lucina. Got my ass whooped 3 times
Dude,
in a row.
Same.
I was so sad that he just broke my brain in half and threw me off the stage. It was insane.
Yeah.
I didn't feel so defeated as much as I just felt embarrassed that I was so cocky in my head.
Yeah.
But it was, regardless, it was a really fun experience. Because afterwards, we went to finals. You have to buy a separate ticket for finals, guys. And we saw one of the most hype plays of, I think, Smash history.
The grand finals set.
The grand finals set was between MKLeo and Tweak, which at the time were the two top players.
Well,
of
MKLeo is still the best. Tweak is, like, number 3, too.
At the time?
Still. Current day.
Well, current day. But at the time, they were just, like...
Yeah,
there was
a rivalry
between those two.
And these
and
are both American players?
These are both American players.
Well,
no, sorry. MKLeo's from Mexico.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So
they're international best.
Yeah.
International
best.
Three.
Yeah, yeah.
Exactly. And MKLeo got into loser's bracket pretty early on. So in order for him to win finals, he had to win, I think it was 6 games in a row?
Against Tweak. Yeah.
Against Tweak. Because
yeah.
He was the best... 3 out of 5?
But yeah.
Best 3 out of 5.
Mm-hmm.
MKLeo lost the first 2 games, and I was like, okay, man, Tweak has it in the bag. He only needs to win 3 times to win the whole tournament. But MKLeo went, there's like something that we called it, like Ultimate Leo or something.
Yeah, wait, was it? Did he actually reverse 6-0 or was
he
it?
He reverse 6-0'd Tweak.
Was it a 6-0?
It was a crazy comeback. It was a crazy
okay, so it was a
6-0 comeback. Where he was down and out, and he won the first game. We're like, oh, cool. Tweak still has this in the bag. Tweak fumbled all those 5 games afterwards, and it was just screaming
damn.
From the crowd. It was like, MKLeo really did that. MKLeo really reverse tweak.
Yeah.
And it honestly, I got my money's worth. It wasn't some BS like the last Smash 4 tournament where it's just
bayonets. Yeah, no, like Smash is obviously amazing as a party game. I'm sure pretty much everyone watching probably plays Smash casually, but like as a competitive sport, it's so much fun. It's like there's so much depth to it, and there's like all these storylines and stuff.
Smash is a party game, it's not a fighting game. Get your head out of your ass.
You're right. Yeah, but it's crazy. Also, being in tournament is a crazy experience because like you play so much worse.
I get nervous.
If you're like me and Jesse, like you play so much worse. We're pretty good, but we're not like a competitive.
I don't lab
player.
Anything. I know.
What does lab mean?
Lab is just like going into the practice mode and doing the same like combo for 40 minutes straight.
Yeah.
It's all you can do in Smash. Really.
Grinding
it out, just trying to get that muscle memory in. And I wasn't much of a fan of that. I was more of like on the fly. Oh crap, I can do this. Oh crap, I can do that. And
I feel you.
I just did it. I just ran with it. Which I found really fun. I know that you and your brother labbed a lot. Your brother labs way more than you.
I don't lab.
You don't lab?
No.
Alex is just here flexing. I'm just that good.
I just play Funny Frog.
But see, that's the reason like why I can't play games like Pokemon. Because it's just so much grinding. And it's just so much downtime. You know?
So you're saying you won't get into competitive like gaming ever, right?
No, I don't think I'd ever. I almost exclusively play single player games for the story.
Persona.
So you play Persona.
Do you
grind in Persona?
There's only two games that I can play. Two turn-based games that I can play. Is Persona and some Pokemon games.
Some Pokemon. Okay.
Yeah.
But
I barely can stand Persona.
Because I enjoyed Persona.
Mm-hmm.
I liked grinding in Persona.
Really?
Yeah. Because like what I would do is in the game Persona, it's like a day-based game where there's all of them.
Oh,
like
okay.
Three to five. It's a day-based thing where there's a time limit, and I said how long you have until you can beat a dungeon. And I would just beat the dungeon all at once.
Yeah, that's what I would do.
Like, in a single day. Because the thing is, you're supposed to space it out because you run out of like the equivalent of mana.
Whatever, yeah.
And I'm like, no, I'm not about to waste this day and not go on these dates with cute girls.
Yes, exactly. See, that's the thing.
You
just play Persona or you play the main quest for one day. And then the remaining 2 weeks or 3 weeks,
you're just going on dates with girls.
Just
life simulator.
That's literally
yeah.
it. It's for people who don't know how to talk to girls in real life.
It's fun though. Persona changed my life.
It is really fun.
Yeah. Please play Persona 5 Royal.
Alex didn't play Royal. Alex didn't play the original. He only played Royal.
I think Royal is a lot better.
Yeah, I should have played Royal, but I just finished 5. And I did not want to get into that again.
Same. I just bought Royal, and I'm like, I bought it for $20, and I'm kind of giving it some cool
down.
It's
at $20 already?
Yeah, on sale, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I bought it last Black Friday for $20, so not just bought it.
Oh, okay.
But I bought it a while ago, and I didn't play it.
And it's just there.
It's just sitting there. I just haven't had time to play it. Although I played Persona 5 Strikers, and that gameplay, have you guys played it?
It's really fun.
The gameplay is so, that's what I think Persona should be.
No.
You know?
No.
Yes, hands down.
Like
the fighting system.
The turn-based and like the original Persona games are really fun.
No, that's
no,
what
no.
really fun. You get me. That's what Pokemon should be,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah, I agree.
Because I've been talking to Alex about this for a while. When Sword and Shield came out, Alex went full soy boy mode. He's like, I'm gonna buy this game day one. I don't care about the bad press. And he like slobbed over all over Nintendo's knob.
I don't
over
think
it.
I did though. I
and
don't
I
think
was,
I did.
I was telling him like, you know, I
no, because legit, because
really
I enjoyed the previous game a lot, so that gave me hope for the next game, naturally. You know?
You saw how it looked, sir!
It could still play well, but it was just actually disappointing. As a single-player experience, Sword and Shield was like the worst Pokemon game, actually. Sadly.
But yeah, Persona 1 and 2, I don't know. 1 and 2 were okay, I thought.
I'm surprised you played 1 and 2.
I played
like
1 and
2. Rarities.
Yeah, it's like,
yeah.
It's okay, I mean.
Doesn't 2 have like Hitler? As in,
I think both of them has Hitler.
No way.
Like, no spoiler spoiler alert, but I think 1, the main villain is Hitler, and then 2, he just makes appearances, or something like that, I can't even remember.
It's pretty hard.
Yeah, it's interesting.
That goes hard.
That goes pretty hard.
Yeah.
Having Hitler as your villain.
But, I mean, that's the whole, like, Persona is like the whole, I don't know if I could say like horror vibe, but like, it's about, you know. I guess it's not really horror, it's like finding your place with your friends.
It's game by game basis. Mm-hmm. Every game has its own like set of vibes. I'm sure Persona 3 was a lot more depressing than Persona 4. Persona 4 is a lot like the happiest in the series, and Persona 5 is like a good in between.
Yeah, Persona 5 is definitely a good in between. But I don't know, Persona 3 is still the best.
So, I mean, speaking of horror, Jesse, you mentioned that you like analog horror videos, right?
Analog horror videos. It's something that's a little more popular now, but I got pretty into it in high school with, like, the... It was Local 58. Local 58 emergency broadcast system. And to put it into simple terms, do you remember when you were a kid and the TV would come on with the emergency broadcast system with a whole, like, blaring alarm? It was a really scary thing.
Wait, that happened to you guys?
Yeah.
When? For what? What?
Well, like,
in reality?
In reality, where you're just, like, sitting down, the emergency broadcast system comes on, it's
right. Like when there's, like, a nuclear strike coming.
No, no, no. Like, it'll say something like, a child was recently abducted.
Oh, okay.
Terrible stuff.
Oh,
so,
you're talking about, like, Amber Alerts. Those freak me out.
It would have the same, like, Amber Alert tone and stuff. So, but basically, the emergency broadcast system thing that I would watch from Local 58 was this whole overarching story of, like, something's going on with the moon, and it is messing with people to the point where, like, they're killing each other, or there's some kind of creature. It would show off an emergency broadcast, and it would say there's a meteorological event going on, don't go outside, don't look at the moon, and it would cut out, and then all of a sudden it'd be like someone else is typing stuff out, like, the moon is safe to look at, go outside. Then it would cut back out, like, do not look at the moon, close all doors, close all windows, don't answer the door no matter how human it may appear. And it's like, oh god, it freaks me out so much. It's just, I love horror. I love the concept of analog horror being like...
No, it's sick because, like, it's meant to feel like things that could happen. Or that could realistically, like, be presented to you in real life. Even though it's, like, hella surreal.
Yeah.
But the fact that, like, it feels real.
It feels grounded in reality in the sense that we have this emergency broadcast system.
Yeah.
The one that really messed me up was Local 58's contingency order. It's supposed to mimic, like, the end of a local channel's broadcast day. And... they somehow mess up and air a contingency message from, like, the 70s or 80s. I think Reagan was the president.
Oh, the one where they filmed it in case the world
In case, like, the Cold War suddenly fell into Russia's favor or something. And it was, like, a message where it's, like, a handwritten letter. It was, like, dear Americans, we're sorry. Our glory-filled country has fallen to our enemy. Take pride in being an American, and then it tells you to off yourself. Like, it shows, like, images of, like, get into the position. It's like a guy going up and in, like, it's just telling you to kill yourself. And the most eerie part about it is at the very end, it talks about children. It's like, tend to your children first. Make, like, off your children. Dude, you're freaking out so bad. After the message airs, it's like they aired an apology. It's like, oh, sorry, this wasn't supposed to happen. We apologize for anybody who may have
killed your children.
With your...
I mean, but this was all part of, like, the whole show.
It's
right?
All
it
part of this, this extended alternate reality that I find very interesting.
Yeah, and it feels like it is kind of a trend on Twitter sometimes, where you'll see, like, real-life footage, and people will edit, like, a huge Leviathan in the clouds or whatever.
Dude, yeah.
Or, like those kind of things, you know?
Blair Witch Project type,
Marvel
Hornets.
Mm-hmm.
Is something that I'm super, super into. Because I love horror. I was scared shitless when I was a kid. But nowadays, horror is my thing. I want to eventually make a horror movie. But, you know, a smart horror movie. I like gore. I don't like very visceral gore. Mm. Very obvious gore. Because there are some very bad films that are just gore filled, and I hate them.
They're just not scary.
It's just a bloody mess.
Yeah.
Saw is an exception because I like the way that Saw does stuff. But
Saw is more psychological.
It's more psychological.
Yeah.
The second movie messed me up pretty bad. But
I can't do horror.
Yeah,
is it the
really
blood
scary.
Or is it the scare?
It's just scare.
I feel on that. I'm not a huge fan of.
Yeah, I'm okay with gore, but, like, just like anticipation, I can't do it.
Mm-hmm.
I love thrillers though because, like, I can sleep with them. Like, I love feeling, like...
Whiplash.
Yeah, or just, like, any thriller I'll enjoy for sure. But if there's a horror element, you know, if there's a nun or a ghost or, like, a freaking demon, I'm like...
Oh, the demons hanging from the ceiling, all that stuff?
I can't do that,
unfortunately. You need to watch
even though, like... Yeah, no, even though, like stuff like Hereditary has such an interesting plot, and I think horror is super interesting, because, like, the fact that horror filmmakers, the only thing, their goal is just, like, scare shit out of you.
Mm.
And they just ask themselves, how do we do that?
I don't know about that.
I don't think
like
that's their main...
No. But it's, like, not scare shit of you, but, like, create a reaction of an audience, you know? Like,
yeah.
They're forcing the audience a reaction, and they...
If I'm ever going to make a horror film, I want to get into the mind of the viewer more than anything else. I want them to feel like, holy crap, what if this creature's right behind me?
Yeah.
For me, what's terrifying is a presence that you cannot stop, and it comes at you relentlessly, and it gets in your head.
Yeah.
Like, paranoia is such a good thing to play with in horror. What was it? The movie It Follows.
Mm.
Do you know what It Follows?
I don't know what It Follows.
So, It Follows is a horror film about an invisible creature that will maim and kill a person who is cursed with this, like, STD. I imagine it's supposed to be some kind of metaphor about just dangerous STDs or whatever, but the only way you can pass this curse down is by having sex with somebody else. So, prime for horny teenagers. That trope was, like, super the thing about the movie, and that's what I kind of hated. But the terror of it is, like, this creature is only seen by the person who has a curse. To everybody else, it's invisible.
Yeah.
And the way this creature blends in is it will look like your average person that's just walking towards you.
So they slowly walk towards
you. They slowly walk towards
you.
Yeah,
which is terrifying. It's more scary than them, like, running at you.
Yeah, there's this really... the scariest scene is when this girl is in her room, paranoid that the creature's right outside her door, and her friends break in, like, there's nobody here. And then the creature is in the hall, and it's just walking. He's this really tall dude who grabs the top frame of the door and, like, comes in and just walks through.
Oh, shit. Like a Slender Man figure?
He's very slender. Not, like, abnormally long, but he just, like, grabs the top and walks through, and it freaks me out so bad that it's just so casual.
And it goes to that, like, feeling of, like...
dread.
Like... relentlessly you're followed, you know,
you are
helpless
because you are in a room, it is crowded, you have to jump out a window at that point.
Have you got that again?
I forgot. I haven't watched a movie in years.
Okay.
But
the thing that I think that's so smart about good horror movies is that, like, the story, I mean, the whole immersion thing, right? You get so immersed in the story that it transcends television. I think that's what's unique about horror, is that no other genre can, besides maybe, like, I don't know, maybe some, like, thrillers or, like, bad rom-coms that people who don't understand what real life is.
Yeah, because, like, once they make the threat feel real, then the horror movie just has you.
Yeah,
like,
it stays in your mind.
Yeah.
It transcends everything.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I like about horror, is that it sticks with you more than other genres of film or just media in general. That's why I really like analog horror, because I feel like, what if there is a presence in my room?
Oh my god.
Just in my corner.
Lovecraftian shit.
Some Lovecraftian
shit.
Yeah. Right?
So, when you say analog horror, do you mean, like, what exactly do you mean by analog horror? Do you mean, like, animatronics?
Why is it called analog? Is
so
it a broadcast or what?
I recently heard that the definition of analog horror is more so media that is constrained to VHS or older TV, like, just media in general.
Mm-hmm.
So, a lot of times you'll get VHS videos, you'll get found footage, imagery photos, like old police training tapes, just this kind of that's what you're constrained to for the most part. So, and people have done a lot with just that medium itself. The guy who's making the analog horror piece that I'm really into right now is actually trying to move away from just analog and just flesh out a little more. And honestly, I think this guy's actually going to push the medium a lot more, which I'm really excited for. I forgot his name. His name is also Alex. He did insert name of what I'm talking about right here. It's great. It has to do with a creature that will come into your home, kill a guest, and then mimic their voice to try to get someone to come
into a
contact with them. And it is terrifying, because they had a bit where some guy calls his friend. He's like, my mom just screamed. I'm going to take her to the hospital or something. Can you come home and, like, turn on the cameras or whatever? So he drives up to the house, turns on the cameras, and heads home.
Wait, why is he turning on the cameras?
Because he fears that there may be some creature there. The creature's called an alternate. And
it's a
creature who, like, mimics people, whatever.
So there's suspicion already.
There's suspicion already.
Gotcha.
He turns on these cameras, he heads home. And it's revealed that this creature followed him home. And it's just like this handheld VHS video of him recording his door, where all you hear is knocking and the voice of his friend going, Mark, I brought you a present, Mark. And like, you can hear his voice like repeating over and over again, like, because it's a creature who can't mimic it perfectly. He's messing his voice up. He's like, I won't hurt you, Mark. It's horrifying thing to think about, because what they'll do too is they'll mimic the voice of people that have died. So in an earlier version of it, there was a guy who was in his house and he heard his mom's voice like, honey, I fell, I need help, please help me, come inside now. And it's like oh dude, that's horrifying. Because if like, Lord, don't let her pass. But if my mom passes away in the future, and I hear her voice coming from a room, I'm like, Mom? And I want to go see if that's her or something, you know? Mm-hmm. Because...
Isn't that the whole plotline of Shang-Chi?
Is it? Shang-Chi and Seven...
And
well,
the Ten Rings.
Well,
ten rings.
It's just like...
lost three rings?
Basically, yeah. Like the ugly like vampire dragon is like speaking to
something
the...
Like
a little bit,
plot.
Yeah.
What a weird plot.
I don't know how I connected that.
What a weird plot.
Shang-Chi was pretty good. I watched it in Mexico with Spanish subtitles.
We watched it too late. I think we didn't really enjoy it as much as we should have.
So when we digitize analog horror, like whatever, like the VHS, would it still then be considered analog horror? Am I getting the definition wrong? Is it like Super 8? Like, you know the movie Super 8 where it's filmed?
I think it really is just more of the look than anything
mm-hmm.
else. Because we would need to digitize it anyway if we're going to use it. If we're going to view it.
Mm-hmm.
So
it's like how movies are still called films.
Exactly. Yeah, it's all digital media now, but we still call it film.
So it's like film photos, but we view it on a computer, but it's still called... A film photo.
Film
photo.
Sure.
Oh, okay.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's still called analog photography. Okay.
I find that also very interesting because I recently got a little card from my desktop that allows me to import mini DV video onto my computer. And I took that camera when I went back to Germany to go visit Oriane, and I recorded a bunch of stuff with it. I bought a secondary VHS camera too. It's pretty great. And I just the whole aesthetic of this... older media, the way the audio comes out and how it's all crunchy.
You can't really recreate it once.
You can replicate it very well,
but not
digitally, but not one to one.
Yeah.
And I really enjoy just that format. I remember Alex and I actually filmed a music video for someone on Twitter where we had both those cameras. He was filming on his A7 III and I was filming on my dad's old camcorder that does mini DV.
Mm-hmm.
And I really like how it came out. There was a little scene where we had the artist and his love interest like at a pier, and I was like focused on the mountains. I pulled out, and you know how when you zoom out, it's just like a very like boom, you're zooming out now.
Yeah.
It's just that look where zoom out, see them in full, zoom in on them, and they're just like embracing and stuff, and it's just a really good look that I love.
Is it like the home, like
home VHS?
VHS
feeling.
Oh,
is exactly what it is.
It's been so long since I touched like a VHS camera. I think last time I was using it, we were still using... I had to transfer the files because I didn't have the tape recorder thing or the whatever converter to, you know, you plug it into your computer.
Yeah.
I had to transfer my files via FireWire to get...
That's exactly
the
FireWire. We don't have FireWire. That was like a Mac-only port that Mac Pros used to have back in the day.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't have a bigger computer anymore. I can't put any expansion cards. I put that expansion card into my brother's computer because he has my old computer now. And I gave him Premiere. So now that dude's editing stuff on his own, which I'm pretty happy about. He's doing super little videos just like me. Shout out to Juan.
How nice.
Alright guys, so we're starving. So that's the end of the podcast. Thanks so much for your time. And thank you, Jesse, for your time.
No, thank you guys. Honestly, this is the first time I've done a full podcast, one that looks so professional.
I hope so.
I enjoyed talking with you guys. I feel very, very open. Like, comment, and subscribe. Follow the Paper Boys, Paper Bridge Collective. It is going to keep on growing. We're going to do great things.
Yes, we are.
Yes, we are. Amen.